Welcome to Union Presbyterian Church Online. You can turn on closed captioning for this time of worship by clicking on the CC button on your YouTube video. If you're watching on a smaller device, you can tap on the three dots to find the CC option. Welcome to this online celebration of all saints, our beloveds who have gone before us, which we will celebrate with the Lord's Supper. You may want to take this time to bring provisions for the meal, bread, and the fruit of the vine. You may also want to mark this time with some symbol, perhaps of your loved ones who have gone before, perhaps of being in God's presence. You may want to light a candle. You may want to bring a photograph or a memento. Your love and memory are precious to God, and they are honored in this time. The Good Shepherd who leads us to green pastures and springs of water is with us. The one who sets a banquet before us, who sends manna from heaven in times of need, will not fail to arrive. A great cloud of witnesses is present. We are glad you are here today.
May we remember that God created. May we remember that God liberated. May we remember that God fed. May we remember that God is still creating. God is still liberating. And God is still feeding us. Let this be our story. Let this be where we begin. Let us worship Holy God.
Swing low, sweet chariot,
coming for to carry me home.
Swing low, sweet chariot,
coming for to carry me home.
I looked over Jordan, and what did I see?
Coming for to carry me home. To carry me home.
Swing low, sweet chariot,
coming for to carry me home.
Swing low, sweet chariot,
coming for to carry me home.
If you get there before I do,
coming for to carry me home.
Tell all my friends I'm coming to.
Coming for to carry me home.
Swing low, sweet chariot.
Coming for to carry me home. To carry me home.
I'm sometimes up, I'm sometimes down.
Coming for to carry me home.
But still my soul feels heavenly bound.
Coming for to carry me home.
Swing low, sweet chariot.
Coming for to carry me home.
Swing low, sweet chariot.
Coming for to carry me home.
We are part of God's story. Let us ask God to help us to remember. Holy God, we admit to remembering the wrong things. We remember worldly lessons like everyone for themselves, an eye for an eye, and all is fair in love and war. And yet we forget to forgive 70 times 7, to love our neighbors as ourselves, and to live like the body of Christ. Why is it so hard to remember the right things? Release us from our muscle memory and recenter us in a new place, a fresh place, a space grounded in your love. Help us to receive your word anew and to consider stewardship not with the world's rules, but with your rules. Help us remember. With hope we pray. Amen. Now I invite you to offer peace to those around you, whether physically around or far away, but in your mind. We begin today with a story that takes place after God's people have escaped slavery. Now they are in the wilderness, with all the challenges that brings. A reading from the book of Exodus, beginning at chapter 16, verse 2. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord." The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.'"
Hello. I'm so happy you're here today. Look where I am. Do you remember this place? It's been a while since we were all here together. I really hope that we will be able to be here together again before too long. I have a question for you. Have you ever been on a trip? Maybe to the grocery store. Maybe somewhere far away. A trip out of town. Who went with you on the trip? Did you go alone? When you leave your house, what does that feel like? Now think about this. What do you suppose it would feel like to be on a trip where you didn't know where you were going or when you would get there? Have you ever felt like that? Did you start to ask questions? What sorts of questions do you think you would ask if you were on a journey like the one the Israelites are on? God's people, the Israelites, were on a long trip. Moses and Aaron had helped them to escape from slavery in Egypt, and at first they were so happy. They had packed their bags and they had gone on their trip, but after a while they ran out of all the food they had packed. And worse yet, they were in a desert, which meant there weren't a lot of plants or animals around. So now they begin wondering how they're going to eat. Can you guess what happened? God gave them food to eat, bread from heaven. Our Bible contains stories that have been handed down from a long, long time ago. Stories about people who lived long ago. But these stories still speak to us today because they remind us of our history. We remember these things. And they remind us how much God loves us. Can you think of a moment when you felt loved? Maybe it's right now, sitting with someone in your family. Maybe it's on a Zoom call with your grandparents. Maybe it's when you get to be with your best friend. Do you know that you are loved by God? You are. God loves you. God wants everyone to have what they need, to have enough. And in this story, that's exactly what God did. Everyone had enough bread to eat and enough to share with everyone in their community. Let's have a prayer. Dear God, thank you for always taking care of us. Help us always to remember how much you love us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm really glad you're here today. Have a wonderful week. We continue with a story that takes place on the night of the Last Supper. A reading from the Gospel according to Luke, beginning at chapter 22, verse 1. Now the festival of unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was near. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to put Jesus to death, for they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered into Judas, called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He went away and conferred with the chief priests and the officers of the temple police about how he might betray him to them. They were greatly pleased and agreed to give him money. So he consented and began to look for an opportunity to betray him when no crowd was present. Holy wisdom, holy word. Thanks be to God. Today is a day for remembering. At each moment in this time of worship, we are remembering some part of God's story or some part of our own stories. First, we heard the story of God's people in the wilderness. The Israelites escaped from slavery, free at last. But now, in their freedom, they find themselves at a perilous moment. Not from the harsh leadership of the Pharaoh, but from the simple fact that they've been on the move for a month, and now they've run out of food. They are afraid. They are afraid they will not have enough. In September, two of my clergy colleagues and I got together on Zoom to talk about money stories. Everyone has a money story, even God. And all three of us, together with the congregations we serve, are seeking to explore these stories, which always revolve around questions like, what is enough? Here you'll hear Pastor Kimberly Chastain from the United Presbyterian Church in Binghamton, and Pastor Rachel Helgeson from Northminster Presbyterian Church in Endwell, and me, all remembering how we learned about money and what it meant in our families and how our understanding and our faith was challenged, how it grew. Not all money stories are comfortable. I think you will hear that. Each of us has memories or experiences or even family history that means the question of will there be enough is very real and a part of the dynamics we learn from and live with. Listen now to these three money stories. And as you do, listen for the uncomfortable parts of the stories. Listen for the parts that show growth, and listen for the parts that indicate that we are still learning, still growing.
I started with this curriculum to have a way to talk about and think about money, as it's been a presence in my life all my life, I guess. I come from financially stable family, from two parents who also came from financially stable families. My mom was actually from relative wealth, and my father was from a good Scottish Midwestern family. And I brought visual aids because I was taught money management from a very early age. My first allowance was a nickel and five pennies. And out of it, a penny went into the piggy bank and a penny went to the church. And this was a Sunday school bank that my great grandmother had that came to me eventually. And it's got a, you can put money in from either the front or the back, but either way, the only person that could open it was the Sunday school superintendent who had a key. But that's not really relevant. It's just, I think it's a fascinating historical thing that this was how children were taught to give to the Sunday school in the day. I grew up with kind of the impression that was debt was shameful, that the only use for credit was to keep the money in your account longer so that you pay everything off at the end of the month, but you've gotten to use your money all month in the meantime. Both my parents had a real emphasis on responsibility and stability, and they believed and taught that they should give each of their children what they needed rather than strictly equal shares. And my mother was always the one emphasizing grace and generosity, and my father responsibility and stability, which meant, you know, learning to keep an account book. And I was always dreadful at it. I had a real shock when I became a single parent because I had never ever known what it was like not to have enough money to plan how to use your money. And so I had to figure out how to carry debt and how to decide between things that might actually all be necessary but couldn't be afforded. And I learned then that the money that you have, you have to have a certain amount of money before you can manage money, because it's very expensive to be poor. And so for me, the grace came first in learning that you could carry debt and not be condemned to hell for all eternity. And second, in learning to ask for help and getting occasional bailouts, mostly from my parents, but occasionally from other people as the situation grew kind of urgent. And now I'm 60 years old and my son is married and has a family of his own and is financially stable and learned all of the lessons my parents tried to teach me much better than I did. But so I value what my folks gave me, but I also value that I learned grace apart from the strict system that was in it. When I think about the three questions in the curriculum, which are, what do you believe about money? How do you use money? And how do you give money? I would say, I believe money is a tool and how I use it expresses my values. I use money to care for myself and my dependents, to support what I believe in, and to travel and acquire things that bring me joy. And I give money to support the congregation that I serve and organizations that I believe in, and occasionally organizations that need assistance. But the money as a tool rather than an indicator of status or of achievement is, I think, a dominant one. And the idea that how you use your money reflects your values is probably the strongest one and always has been. So that's my money story. And If I do give to an individual or to an organization, I never attach strings, either in the gift when I give it or in my own mind. So I'm never keeping score with anybody because I think that creates real dangerous things and I don't want to give anybody else that kind of control.
I think when we first started having this conversation between us, this group of pastors, one of the things that I realized instantly was that a big part of my money story was that my parents didn't talk to my brother and me about money, that there was something secretive going on, that if we asked certain kinds of questions, we were told that was a rude question, questions about money, like how much money they had. Later I learned that my mom's money story was one of extreme poverty during the Depression. Her father died very shortly after the stock market collapse, and she and her siblings and her mom were plunged into very, very serious poverty. Poverty of the really don't know where your next meal is coming from kind. Stories about, of course, holes in the soles of the shoes. And my mother went to Catholic school and she was deeply ashamed at the condition of the soles of her shoes, which other girls could see when she knelt during Mass. Stories of my mother's older sister having a boyfriend who was a bootlegger, who stole a turkey and threw it over the fence and was running from the police as he did so. So that all sounds kind of colorful and film-like, but the effect it had on my mother was that she was terrified of being without money. She made her decision about marrying my father based on her conviction that he was a hard worker and that they would be okay together. They would be safe money-wise because they were both hard workers. And she liked to think of herself as Scarlett O'Hara, as in, as God is my witness, I will never be hungry again. So it's my mom's money story. My dad's money story is different. He had a stable, financially stable childhood because his dad was a butcher and he and his brothers were all trained as butchers from a very early age and they owned a grocery store and they were never without food. They were never without the basic necessities because grocery stores are what we would call an essential service. So they provided an essential service and even during the Depression, they were fine, they were okay. And my dad was a hard worker. Both my parents, they opened a grocery store together and then they transitioned to having a liquor store. And they made a very comfortable life for themselves and for their children. And in some ways for their grandchildren, because my children and my brother's children all, to a certain extent, owe the ability to go to college without any anxiety about debt to my parents and to their other grandparents as well. So when I think about how I am about money myself, I think that I have come under the influence of not being given a lot of information about money and about how to manage money. And I think that's a part of my money story, is that I had to figure that stuff out for myself, especially once I too was a single mom. And I was accustomed to having someone else worry about those things for me as a child and as an adult for a while. And then at the point at which I was able to take that over, I realized that I have always been fortunate in that I've been able to earn enough to not be afraid about money. And I didn't have the experience of being afraid about money. But I also learned that that didn't mean I couldn't think about it. That I had to be I had to be reasonably thoughtful about it. I use money to support myself. And right now I'm really grateful that during this pandemic time, I'm able to offer my home to both my children as I have been able to, because they have been caught up in what it is to be in the arts in a big city and they've had to come home. And so I've been able to do that. And I'm so grateful that I am. I also have been able to give in support of our congregation, and again, in support of other causes that I believe in, probably in a more impulsive way than I would like to. When I see a cause I believe in, I tend to move towards giving pretty quickly without looking at the big picture. So that's an area of growth for me still. And I also, for anyone who's on Instagram, I'm extremely susceptible to Instagram advertisements early in the morning. So if anybody wants my money, they can, if they can find me on Instagram around 7 a.m, I'm a pretty good bet. I'm a pretty good bet that I will buy the thing you are offering me at that time. I'm not proud to say this. I'm just trying to be honest about me and money. So I have, with the help of my son, interestingly enough, I have put some protections in place that are helping me move away from my impulsive Instagram shopping. And that's me. That's my money story.
So my money story is interesting, especially since my mom might be watching this. So love you, Mom, but I'm going to be real about it. My dad grew up in the South, and my grandmother and my grandfather got divorced. And so at that time, women couldn't work in some places by themselves. So my dad had to help out to make sure that my grandma Ruth was able to do the things she needed to do. So it's kind of a strange dichotomy. And even now, like thinking about my grandma having to depend on my dad, like she was a very fierce lady. So for her to have to ask my dad to come with her is just, I can see a dichotomy for both of them, that they understood it was survival, not about what they needed to do. So so my dad had just sort of figured out like how to try to take care of people. And that was sort of his story, is that, you know, they lived in poverty. His grandfather, who was in New York City, would help out when needed. But my grandma Ruth wouldn't be so forthcoming about that all the time because she was nervous about it and didn't want to disappoint her father. So God bless her. She did the best she could in a time frame when that wasn't as normal. Whereas my mom's story, my grandfather was an only child, and we have this huge Bible from the family that we think is probably from when they were railroad barons back in the whenever day. And so my mom never really had to want for things. She was the first girl in generations, so like had an account at a local boutique, and things would just show up from grandparents to, you know, as gifts. And my grandfather worked an extra job because they came out of depression. So even though he had stuff, he still was worried about like making sure there was always enough. And so there was like always more than enough. So my mom didn't really ever have to think about that. So my mom married a pastor who came out of this. So I joke about that because my mom's lifestyle was different than that of a pastor who especially grew out of the South, out of more poverty. And so that led to some interesting times. But what I learned from that was how to, as an oldest child, help out. So that was one of the things I would try to help and make sure that we had enough. For some of you who think about childcare, I was doing babysitting when I was like 8 years old because it was the 80s. I don't recommend that now. but so I've worked like as long as I can remember, honestly, doing something or helping somebody, or my sister would go door to door with rocks and sell them to people and they would buy them for like $5. She's really good at selling things. I am not. But it's But there's always this worry of scarcity. And I still sometimes have to fight that in myself, that is there going to be enough? And I usually have to ground myself back in scripture, that not to worry about it, that to pay attention to what is needed and try to see where I need to make sure things are given, but not to get so caught up in the scarcity, because it's so easy to get caught up in scarcity, especially when there's trauma or when things don't seem like they're working out exactly the way you expect them to. Which is why I've really been grateful for this region. I've watched how folks have had to live out of complicated situations, and there always seems to be enough. And I say that in a way that has been really humbling. I've seen that in my own congregation. I've seen that within our presbytery. I've seen that within the broader Southern Tier, Binghamton, Endicott, Endwell community, that, like, I was driving by earlier today and saw a sign outside Union Endicott, come on in, there's a pantry here. You know, I've driven by United Binghamton and seen how people gather in the foyer pre-COVID to, like, just have a place to sit. And so to me, that's not living in scarcity, that's living in abundance of God's love. And so it may not be quite as much money as that we think we have, but there's always ways that we can give. And so that's been part of my growth. So is that my dad used to talk about, like, Rachel, it's always good to give to the church and to other places that you think that God's calling you to. And so I was always nervous about that, because I'm like, well, I'm not going to have enough. Like, in the back of my head, that's what I would be thinking. So I started off really small. And now I can say that I give more than I ever have. And sometimes I'm always like, is this too much? But it always seems to work out. So that's one of those walking by faith and not by sight. And even my own, like, internal dialogue is still working through that. But it always works out. I think that must be a God thing, because it's not a me thing or a situation thing.
We read another story this morning, the story of Judas conspiring with the religious leaders to have Jesus killed. And money is a part of that story, as it so often is in Jesus' story. It is profoundly uncomfortable, this story. As so often is the case, money is caught up in power dynamics and deadly intentions. But this is also a story of unfathomable grace. Even though Jesus makes a strong statement of Judas's culpability, as the story unfolds, Judas is still at table with him. Judas takes and eats the bread. Judas drinks from the cup. Jesus does not ban even Judas from the table of grace. You may or may not know this, Jesus talks more about money than he talks about anything else. More than he talks about prayer. More than he talks about the kingdom of God. More than he talks about his own crucifixion or discipleship. And that's because money stories are spiritual stories. For where our treasure is, there will our hearts be also. Both show us what we place at the center of our lives. God loves us. God wants us to have enough, and so God provides enough. God wants us to thrive, and wants us to thrive in community. No one is an island. Today is a day for remembering so many things: our stories, the stories of our faith community, the stories of those who have gone before us, and God's love that welcomes us to the table, that love that provides enough, that love is what binds us together. Thanks be to God. Amen.
If ever there was any doubt about the generosity of the people of Union Presbyterian Church, our experience in the year 2020 should put that doubt to rest. In a time of significant suffering for some and unprecedented uncertainty for all, the church family has not only kept the varied activities of UPC running, we have increased efforts to support and help those in need, both inside and outside our congregation. Our food pantry volunteers, for example, have provided more food than ever before, even in the face of restrictions and challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic. And our congregation has donated thousands of dollars to the pantry to support them as they scaled up the operation to meet the increased need. Clients of our pantry might literally think of us as supplying bread from heaven. Our congregation has also donated thousands of dollars to a COVID-19 fund, which has been used to support church members who have struggled with lost income due to the pandemic. And at the same time, pledges and donations to our local mission, which operates the church, have kept pace with last year. When a community goes through a tough time, leading institutions need to step up. And UPC has definitely stepped up this year for our fellow citizens. We are deeply grateful for your generous support. Our stewardship campaign this year takes a different form, as you know if you've opened the manila envelope that was mailed to you last week. By the way, if you didn't receive one, please leave a message on the church phone and we'll get a packet out to you. We invite you to read and reflect on the many stories, poems, and artworks in the Our Money Story Journal, all designed to help us to a deeper understanding of our own money story and how we can best act to make our little corner of humanity more fruitful and more just. One thing that hasn't changed this year is the pledge card that is included in the stewardship packet. It provides space to record your goals for giving to UPC's four main ministries: general mission for outreach into the community, including the food pantry; the Board of Deacons for personal support of those in need; the historic Riverside Cemetery; and local mission for day-to-day operations of the church. Please return the pledge card to the church by mail, or if you happen to be in the church building, you can drop it in the box in the library. These pledges are very helpful as we work to build an informed budget for 2021. We are grateful for your ongoing support of Union Presbyterian Church and its multifaceted mission in Endicott, New York. May your reflection on your own personal money story lead to greater understanding and continued commitment. Thank you.
The church is one foundation. Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is His new creation by water and the Word. From heaven He came and sought her to be His holy bride. With His own blood He bought her, and for her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth, one holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food, and to one hope she presses with every grace endued. Mid toil tribulation and tumult of her war, she wakes the consummation of peace forevermore, till with the vision.
Reading from John Donne's Devotions Upon Emergent Occasions. The Church is Catholic, universal. So are all her actions. All that she does belongs to all. When she baptizes a child, that action concerns me, for that child is thereby connected to that head, which is my head too, and engrafted into that body whereof I am a member. And when she buries a man, that action concerns me. All mankind is of one author and is one volume. When one man dies, one chapter is not torn out of the book, but translated into a better language. And every chapter must be so translated. God's hand is in every translation. And that hand shall bind up all our scattered leaves again, for that library where every book shall lie open to one another. As therefore, the bell that rings to a sermon calls not upon the preacher only, but upon the congregation to come, so this bell calls us all. No man is an island entire of itself. Any man's death diminishes me, because I am involved in mankind, and therefore never send to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. We will now have the naming of the saints. Robert Regal, husband of Deborah Regal and father to Nathan and Samantha. Jean Robinson, mother of Debbie Rathfon. David Lane, brother of Christy DeLapp. John Hubbard, father of Ruth Allstat. Gloria Daly, mother of Barbara Ann Daly. Miriam Olin, member. Donald Dupre, brother-in-law of Becky Conklin. Ken Pollock, father of Maureen Mueller. Ava Woken, mother of Carl Woken. George Daly, father of Barbara Ann Daly. Tim Peters, uncle of Sandy Peters, and Kathy Peters, aunt of Sandy Peters. Richard Andrus, brother of Peg Williams. Marge Corson, member and mother of Pat Marcello. Tom Decker, member. Margaret Turner, mother of Susan Troy. Richard Stork, member and husband of Gretchen Stork. Bill Dyer, member and husband of Lynn Dyer. Let us pray. Number us among your saints, O God, and join us with the faithful of every age, that strengthened by their witness and supported by their fellowship, we may run with perseverance the race that is set before us, and may with them receive the unfading crown of glory when we stand before your throne of grace. Give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when with the redeemed of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. Amen. The dinner table is always a place where we tell stories. We tell stories of growing up and falling in love, of making mistakes and figuring it out. We tell stories that make us laugh, stories that make us cry, and stories that help us remember. This table is no different. For at this table, we tell stories about a God who loves us unconditionally. We tell stories about a man who fed the hungry, washed the feet of his disciples, and said, "This is my body for you." So friends, as you come to this table today, bring your stories, stories about who you are and who you want to be, stories of shame and disappointment, stories of fear and faith. Bring your money stories, your faith stories, your love and heartbreak stories. Bring them all. For no matter the narrative, God welcomes you to this table. You belong here. Your seat has been saved for you. Creator God, prayer has never been easy for us. Our mind flutters with news updates and questions of faith, our thoughts like a river that won't stop. So today, we take a deep breath. Inhaling your name into the cobwebs of our lungs, willing your presence to wipe away the dust of self-doubt and fear. And with that breath, we ask that you would tell us again. Tell us again how you moved over the waters. Tell us again how you led them with a pillar of fire. Tell tell us again of that still small voice. And then tell us of the prophets. Tell us of Mary and Joseph and that angel chorus. Tell us of the blind man and the leper and the crowds that you healed. Tell us what it was like to walk on water. Tell us of the little children that ran to you. Tell us of the justice you preached. Tell us of the hosannas and the palm branches. Tell us again of the love that changed the world. Tell us again, because we are forgetful people. It is part of our human nature. That is why we long for this space week after week, so that we might be reminded of who we are and whose we are. So tell us again. Tell us again how it all began. Tell us of manna in the wilderness and the disciples around the table. Tell us how, on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and remembered your love and thanked you for it, and how he broke the bread and shared it with his friends, saying, "Take this gift, all of you, and eat it. This is my very life given for the world." Tell us again how he took the cup and poured it out. Tell us how he poured it, like the water of life flowing, and said, "Take this and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood flowing, giving life for the whole world." Remember, tell us this story again. Tell us again of your love for this world. Tell us how it changes everything. Change our lives and those for whom we pray this day. Those who have tested positive for COVID-19, especially those we know and love. Essential workers who continue to place themselves at risk for our benefit, especially those we know and love. Those facing serious illness, especially Judy's brother, Bob. Those recovering from surgery, especially June and Keith. Those in rehab, especially Jerry and Perry. Those affected by wildfires and hurricanes. For all places where people are killed because of race, religion, sexual orientation, gender expression. For Cameroon, grieving the attacks that killed children in their schools. For France, reeling from recent violence. For the United States of America, in this week in which we choose our leaders by vote. For all who need to hear the message of your love, the love that changes lives. Tell us again so that we have the strength to tell others. And as you do, pour out your spirit on this table. Tether your spirit to our fragile bones. Be with us in these ordinary symbols of extraordinary love. And give us the strength to remember your story anew. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. As we prepare to eat together as your disciples did, we remember and we speak that truth out loud, praying, debtors, trespassers, and sinners together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The gifts of God are for the people of God. You are invited to take communion wherever you are. and to know that we are one, one in Christ's body, and God is with us. Please join me in our prayer after communion. Holy God, as we leave this table, help us to remember this moment. Help us to remember that with you, all are invited. Help us to remember that with you, there is a seat for everyone. Help us to remember that with you, there is enough food to go around. That even Judas was invited to the meal, and that there is manna in the wilderness. Help us remember so that as we go, we can build tables like this in the world. We need more tables like this in the world. Gratefully we pray. Amen.
From all nations, all tongues and all peoples, countless the crowd, but their voices are one. Vast is the sight, and majestic their singing. God has the victory, he reigns from the throne. On is their thirst, and no more shall they hunger. God is their shelter, his power at their side. Sun shall not
As you go into the rest of this day and the beginning of this week, I invite you to remember times of abundance and times of discomfort. Times when there was enough and times when enough felt far away. And I invite you to remember that God was with you in all those times. And God is with you now. And God will continue to be with you in all your days. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit be with each of us this day and forevermore. God is with us. Go in peace. Thanks be to God. Amen.